Hi, and welcome to CVS Health Live. Thank you for joining us for today's conversation about all things COVID-19 testing. My name is Jessica DeMassa. I'm a health innovation reporter with What's the Future Health. I cover health and technology, but today I am really excited to host this episode and talk to you about COVID-19 testing. So without further ado, let's introduce you to our panel of experts. From CVS Health, we have Dr. Dan Knecht. He is the Vice President of Health Strategy and Innovation. And our special guest is Dr. George Benjamin. He is the Executive Director of the American Public Health Association. So doctors, welcome. It's a pleasure to have you with me today.
Hi, Jess. How are you?
I'm doing great. How are you doing?
All right.
Good. Yeah, no, I'm excited to talk about this. So just to put this conversation in a little bit of context for those who are watching, I mean, obviously COVID-19 testing becoming a topic of conversation and rising importance as our country is moving to reopen. Alongside this, CVS Health has launched some really exciting news about the work that they're doing to bring self-swab COVID-19 testing to the drive-thrus and parking lots of some of their locations, with the goal of hitting 1.5 million tests per month from about 1,000 different locations. At the same time, we have CVS Health's Chief Medical Officer, Dr. Troy Brennan. He's issued an op-ed talking about how we need to change our thinking about our national testing strategy so that we can provide greater capacity and greater access. And so there's just a lot swirling around this right now. And I'd love to jump in and get you guys to talk to me a little bit about what all of this means as we move forward with reopening our country. So I guess to kick things off, Dr. Knecht, I'll pick on you first. Catch us up with where we're at with COVID-19 testing at this point right now, and also kind of what needs to change moving forward as we continue to reopen?
Yeah, absolutely. So first of all, let's just talk, what is testing? Why is it so important? So until there is effective treatment or a vaccine for COVID-19, the most powerful tool we have in combating this unprecedented crisis is testing. So essentially there are two types of tests. There are the antigen-based tests. So those are tests that look for the presence of the virus in the individual you're testing. So you're looking either for genetic material of the virus or a protein that's on the shell of the virus. So that's antigen testing. And what's so powerful about that test is you're able to identify at that one moment in time if that individual is infected. And why is that important to know? Because this virus is highly infectious. It's more infectious than a seasonal flu, which in and of itself is pretty infectious. So the idea here is to identify somebody who's actively infected and then provide a care pathway. So that includes, first of all, triaging the level of illness for this individual, but also quarantining and isolating that individual so he or she does not propagate or spread the virus. So that's antigen testing. And this is like the most important tool we have. The other type of test are antibody tests. A lot of excitement in this space too. So an antibody is essentially a protein that the body manufactures or produces when they are exposed to a virus. So generally antibodies are produced several days after being exposed to the virus. And what is exciting about this test is it may first of all, you're able to tell if you were infected with the virus in the past. And potentially, we don't know this yet, it may identify somebody who is immune to a subsequent infection.
Okay.
I would say that the excitement of this of the antibody test has surpassed our clinical understanding around immunity right now. But hopefully that'll change in the next few months.
Dr. Benjamin, can you talk to me a little bit about how these two tests work together in terms of helping us reopen more safely?
Yeah, these are very important tests. And I just, you know, it's important to remember that we have been understanding the concept of contact tracing, which is the ability to track people since the early 1900s. I mean, this is a very, very important skill that public health has been doing for many, many, many years. And what the test does is it adds specificity to the ability to do contact tracing. In the old days, when someone got sick in a community and we went to look to see whether or not they got sick from a restaurant or from the water or from another person, you know, we didn't have tests. But now in modern age, we have the ability to test and find out if someone is one of the infectious people. and then who has been, they've been around, and then trace them around. And that way we can contain it. So that's how we got rid of and controlled smallpox. That's how we were almost got rid of polio. We're close. And in the early days of HIV/AIDS, we used testing and contact tracing as tools to better understand the risk of that disease and how best to contain it. These are amazing tools that public health works, but they work together. It's testing, contact tracing, isolation, and quarantine as a packet in order to contain the disease.
I guess I'm curious about with contact tracing, there's a lot of, I guess, debate about it in terms of what it means from a surveillance standpoint. Are there people who have privacy concerns? What would you say about that?
You know, the privacy concerns are very important. But again, we've been doing this for many, many years. And the people that are trained to do this, particularly the disease intervention specialists of our nation, work for governmental public health departments, and they're very good at talking to people and getting them to share things that they probably don't want to share, but also because they build the trust. And trust is a central element here, that I'm going to hear about you. I'm only going to share that information with other trusted individuals in a trusted way so that we can contain it and make sure not only are you going to be healthier, but protect your family and protect the community. So it does take some work, it does take some trust. And by the way, we're ramping this up on a very large scale. And so we have to make sure that privacy is a prime consideration in what we do.
I do want to pick on that point for a second here, and I want to talk about the test results themselves. So can you guys give me a sense of what happens right now with those test results? So someone goes and gets a COVID-19 test or an antibody test, and then what happens to those results? Like, how fast does a patient get those results? And then beyond the patient, where do those results go? Do they go into like an electronic health record at their doctor's office? Is there like a national repository capturing this information for contact tracing? Dr. Knecht, I'll start with you real quick, if you can give me kind of a sense of the pathway of those testing results.
Yeah, sure. So currently in our drive-through testing sites, there are two different modalities we use. One is a point of care test where the individual does self-swab under supervision, and then that swab is then run at a point of care device at the site, and within 30 minutes an answer is given. And that's really powerful because it's so real time, and that essentially reduces the risk of an individual waiting for the result and potentially spreading it to other individuals. So that's a point of care approach. The other approach, which a number of national labs are doing, we call swab and send. So the individual performs a self-swab under supervision, and then that's mailed off to a large reference lab, and essentially the answer it takes some time, and within 1 to 3 days, I think what's important to mention is that all individuals who are positive for COVID-19, that information is provided to the Department of Public Health, and the health authorities can follow up on that very important contact tracing that Dr. Benjamin laid out for us. I think one other modality, which is just starting to arrive, is home-based testing, and that is essentially a self-swab under telehealth supervision, and then that is also sent off to a lab. And then so that's another additional potential resource, but clearly a very rapidly evolving space.
Yeah, and so while you're waiting for results, the intention is to stay at home, correct? While you are waiting for your results, okay. As Dr. Knecht said, you know, so those test results go. If you are positive, it does go to the Department of Health, and is that the information then that's being used to support the contact tracing?
That's correct. And you remember that the challenge in our healthcare system is pretty fractured. So obviously, if your doctor gets it, the doctor will hopefully put it in your medical record. If it's done by one of the clinical labs, that clinical lab, of course, knows who you are. And your doctor and you, if you have access to the laboratory information, and many of us do now with these new apps, we can actually go in and look at our own lab tests. We would have access to that. So anyone that you allow to have access to your record, of course, would have access to that. But the health department has it. And they have it for the purposes of doing the contact tracing. So they know who you are. They know where you live, And they then call you to find out who your contacts were, or they may knock on your door if it's an outreach worker that's part of the health department that does that. But again, they share that information only within the public health system. And when you see these national numbers, those are usually de-identified information. In other words, the fact that the newspapers and the TV studios have these numbers means they have numbers, but not your name.
Okay, good. I think that kind of puts a lot of maybe anxiety at ease there. I wanted to ask about testing capacity, because this is something that has been a topic of conversation from the very, very beginning. Do we have enough tests? How many tests are enough? And I've heard, just like everyone else, so many different numbers thrown out there. So I was reading something the other day, and it was published by Harvard. They had pulled together a group of experts who had put together a pathway to pandemic resilience, which just sounds incredible. But what they were saying is that we need about 20 million tests a day in order to achieve that. I mean, that's what they're recommending. I mean, others have recommended much lower numbers. So what do we really need in terms of testing capacity? I mean, especially as we're just getting ahead or on top of testing right now in the States.
Well, let me just say that we really need to have a good testing plan. And because that number drives the number of tests we need. So initially we were testing people because we were only testing people we thought were symptomatic. Primarily to screen them or for clinical purposes to make sure if they were in the hospital, that was part of the diagnostic workup. But as we begin to try to return back to our communities, we're going to need to be able to test a whole range of other folks, including not just people who've been sick, but people who've been exposed. We're going to have to test people who are in public-facing jobs or particularly people in high-risk jobs. And so the periodicity in which we check workers will ultimately drive the test. So you've seen a lot of numbers, and those numbers continue to change as we begin to think about what the various scenarios are we want to do. When we were all sequestered in our homes, the number was like 500,000 a day, even though we were way below that. And then now 900,000 a day. And as you know, that number continues to grow. So it depends on what the ultimate goal is. I don't think we know for sure, but I can tell you that it's at least 900,000 tests a day nationally, and probably much more than that at the end of the day.
Okay. How often should somebody be tested? So like, as we go back to work, like how often do you get tested and what should trigger a test?
You know, we don't really know. And again, we really need to sit down and figure that out as part of a national plan so that we're all doing it the same way. So for example, we know that, some people are being tested daily because of the high risk of exposure. And some people in some health systems, for example, are being tested every few days, in order to be able to go back to work. I think it really depends on your exposure, but you know that as we get better tests, tests that are highly sensitive and highly specific and have a rapid turnaround, it'll be easier to do those tests on a more frequent and periodic basis.
The only thing I'll add is that we need to make testing accessible and affordable. And so, as you mentioned earlier, CVS is rolling out about 1,000 testing sites by the end of May. And the idea is to get testing in communities across the country where individuals who need tests can access them quickly, effectively, and not have any barriers, whether it be geographic barriers or financial barriers. So, that is an important call out as well.
Can you guys weigh in? I feel like you both keep talking about the national testing strategy. Can you give us an idea of who's coordinating that and what's going on? And I know, Dr. Knecht, we opened up talking about the fact that CVS's chief medical officer is calling for a different approach to national testing. But, what's that process like? And Dr. Benjamin, from your organization, I'm sure you guys are weighing in. So how is this being coordinated?
The challenge is we don't have a really robust national testing strategy. We really need one. But many people are stepping up to the plate. Companies like CVS you have your corporate strategy that you're working on. I know you're coordinating that with federal authorities. And that's a good thing. I know that there are people who are at some of the academic centers who are coming out with numbers. And many of them, of course, are talking to a whole range of public officials, both at the federal level, state, and local level, in order to try to advise folks on what to do. We're way behind the curve on testing, that's for sure, but we're trying to catch up. And hopefully, you know, the United States has an enormous capacity to do this kind of science. And the more we unleash it and the more we coordinate it, the better we'll be.
How do we begin solving for this? I guess, what is the next most logical step here in terms of moving forward? I mean, Dr. Benjamin, you had mentioned, you know, there are retailers like CVS who are working on this, or other businesses that are trying to coordinate with health systems and governments. I mean, is it partnerships moving forward? I mean, what's the next logical step in your opinions?
Yeah, well, I always believe in partnerships. Now, at the federal level, we know the point man for this is Dr. Brett Garrar. Admiral Garrar is clearly the federal point man. And I would encourage everyone to recognize, you know, he's the guy at the center at the federal level. But at the local level, at the state level, the state health officer is important. And at the local, at the city level, particularly the big cities, the city health commissioner or county health commissioner is your point of contact.
Dr. Knecht, did you want to weigh in on that?
Yeah, I just want to reiterate the importance of private-public partnerships. We've been working closely with the federal government, a number of state governments, local communities, you know, just because, as Dr. Benjamin mentioned earlier, the healthcare system is such a patchwork. We need to have sort of unprecedented levels of collaboration to be, you know, to sort of roll back on this pandemic.
I mean, I really love the idea of reaching out into the community further too, because I think right now there's been, you know, limited access to testing depending on where you live. And, you know, you hate to see your zip code define any further your health circumstances, even though we do know that that does have bearing on it. You hate to think that it might limit your ability to get a COVID-19 test as well. I wanted to ask you, Dr. Benjamin, especially, you know, from a public health standpoint, I mean, what are your concerns right now, I guess, as we are putting together this national strategy for testing and starting to roll it out? I mean, what are the things that are maybe keeping you up at night with this?
Yeah, my biggest concern is the lack of focus on communities at highest risk. So communities of color, people who are public facing, people who have challenges getting to the mobile test sites because they don't have a car, or the transportation systems don't get you there, particularly in rural communities, also in our inner cities. So I think that's a big challenge. And, you know, there are all kinds of solutions that the public health community have used over the years, including mobile vans to go to rural communities and go to communities in inner cities that work quite well. Obviously, building it on existing infrastructure like CVS's centers are very important.
So Dr. Knecht, I mean, I'm going to turn to you then too. I mean, I'm sure you're thinking about these things as well, especially in your role helping define strategy over at CVS Health. So what about you? I mean, what are some of the concerns that you have, you know, as our national testing strategy is being rolled out?
Yeah, I mean, I think this crisis is yet again laying bare the health equity issues as it relates to individuals in our society. So thinking about how we can bring access to those communities of color, rural communities, because we know that African-Americans and Latinos are at higher risk for poor outcomes as it relates to COVID for a number of reasons. So, you know, we need to, you know, double down our efforts on fighting hard to have more equitable access and quality of care. You know, CVS, we're leveraging our data analytics and identifying areas, counties that are particularly hard hit, and we're doing proactive calls and educating our members. And so that's a data-driven approach where we can try to close some of the gaps around these issues. But, you know, this is going to take sort of a Herculean effort on all of our parts.
And I know, go ahead.
And let me add one other community to that we continually, I often forget, and I shouldn't, is the Native American community, which is right now really being devastated. And we need to have additional solutions for that community.
Absolutely. You know, I know we're in early days here. And, you know, I mean, we started off talking about, and Dr. Knecht, you mentioned, you know, by the end of May, hoping to have those testing sites up in the parking lots and drive-thrus at 1,000 different CVS stores. But I think, you know, as this starts to unfold and we get through the summer and we look to the fall, what happens with flu season? I know everybody is starting to talk about that already. So, I mean, how do you see this playing out? And I know, you know, obviously things are shifting on a daily basis, if not like an hour by hour basis, depending on where you're going, what news you're seeing. So, I mean, for the two of you, as you see this rolling out into the fall, tell me how this works, you know, through the summer and then with flu season in the fall, what are some of the extra things that need to be considered for the testing strategy as it continues to evolve further into the year?
Well, clearly over the summer it's contact tracing, testing, and good data analysis about what's happening as we reopen, and opening once so that we pause until we get our hands around any new outbreaks that we get, and then continue to move forward so that we don't do it too quickly. That's going to be important.
Oh, sorry. Yeah, just you sparked an idea. Yeah, so I would say definitely massively increasing the quantity and access to testing. But when, you know, we have to prepare for flu season, so we need to, you know, redouble our efforts around influenza vaccinations, in particular populations at increased risk for poor outcomes. And also just in terms of diagnostics, clearly we're focused on, you know, COVID-19, but also rolling out diagnostics for other respiratory pathogens like influenza and RSV.
Okay. And paying a lot of attention to the supply line, because the reagents and the availability of swabs and the availability of vials and all of the things that one needs if you're actually going to do the test are just as important as doing the test, because if you don't have that stuff, you can't do the test.
So, I mean, I guess to wrap this up, you know, I mean, and I think thank you guys so much for being so candid and kind of some of the challenges that we're really facing here. I mean, and it sounds like as we're evolving forward in this national testing strategy, there are so many different factors to consider here. You know, I mean, I guess leave us with some final thoughts. I'm gonna start with you, Dr. Benjamin. From a public health standpoint, I mean, as far as, you know, some of the things your organization is advocating for or concerned about, you know, I mean, how would you recommend that we approach this national testing strategy or rolling out testing into our communities more broadly, so that it really can, you know, that combination of testing and isolation and contact tracing, like you said, can really be almost like preventative medicine for COVID-19. I mean, we can't prevent it right now. We're waiting on a vaccine. But I mean, from your perspective, like, what do we need to do?
You know, we have 5 months of experience, both with the virus and our response. We know there are many things we can do better, because you can always do better. So the goal, I think, is to take the learnings we've had over these 5 months and move forward and do much more testing and focus that testing and do really strong science-based data-driven decisions through strong partnerships, both with corporate America, with governmental public health, and with the community.
All right, Dr. Knecht, what would you add to that?
I'll just say that we have proven techniques above and beyond testing, which is clearly critically important. It's physical distancing, wearing masks outside, good hygiene, hand hygiene, and try not to touch your face. And then also, I think something we have to focus on is the, you know, repercussions of physical distancing. So staying in touch with people who are vulnerable or living alone. I think we're going to be struggling with a mental health crisis if we don't figure out ways to keep people engaged in the community while being physically distant.
All right. Well, thank you both for, again, your candor. I think you've given us a lot of things to think about, and I really appreciate what you've outlined here in terms of both the opportunities and also some of the things that are challenges that still need to be, you know, mitigated as we move forward. So thank you so much. I hope our audience learned as much as I did about what's going on right now and moving forward in terms of COVID-19 testing. Dr. Benjamin, if folks want to keep in touch with you or want to hear more from the American Public Health Association, how do they find you?
Well, you know, my email is actually on the website.
There you go.
APHA.org. That's APHA.org. We have an amazing website on a whole range of public health issues, including COVID-19.
All right, and Dr. Knecht, I know you are a part of CVS Health, and so CVS Health, if folks want to follow along, maybe see more episodes of CVS Health Live, please follow CVS Health on social media. And for all of the COVID-19 information coming out of the company, please take a look at their website, cvshealth.com/COVID-19 is where all of those resources are. So thank you again, Dr. Knecht, Dr. Benjamin. It was a pleasure to speak with you. And thank you to our audience. Thanks for joining us. I'll talk to you soon.
Thank you.
Thank you.